Mob Nation is out now.
The best of the Jerry Ryan Show comedy series on one fantastic album.
It's bleeding better than Nicky from Boy's Life.
Sign the contract.
Get your knobs out for Ireland.
Available now in all good record stores and some crap ones as well.
RTE, supporting the knobs.
19-92. The Jerry Ryan Show. Monday to Friday, 9 till 12 on 2FM.
The book we are about to consider this morning has been simultaneously described as morally disgusting and as one of the most fascinating projects in publishing history. It's called If I Did It by Mr. O.J. Simpson, in which he reveals how he might have carried out the murder of his ex-wife Nicole Brown and Ron Goldman. Here's a short passage from his apparently hypothetical account. I looked down and saw her on the ground in front of me, curled up in a fetal position at the base of the stairs, not moving. Goldman was only a few feet away, slumped against the bars of the fence. He wasn't moving either. Both he and Nicole were lying in giant pools of blood. I've never seen so much blood in my life. I again looked down at myself, at my blood-soaked clothes, and noticed the knife in my hand. The knife was covered in blood, as were my hand and wrist, and half my right forearm. So let's recap. 1995 is the year. To the surprise of even his closest friend, O.J. Simpson was found not guilty of this crime. But in 1997, a civil court ordered him to pay $33.5 million to the respective families for willfully and wrongfully causing the deaths of Ron and Nicole. To fulfil the terms of this settlement, a Florida judge awarded the rights of the book to the Goldmans. Ron Goldman's sister, Kim, joins us now from our London studio. Kim, good morning and welcome.
Good morning, Jerry.
Let's go back in time to 95 and what happened then, and what your belief was at that time.
In 95 when he was acquitted?
Yeah.
At that point I was just shocked and
did you have any faith in the judgment?
I'm confused. Did I have any faith in the fact that he was in the system or when we moved
That he was acquitted. Did you have any faith in the system that it had happened? He was acquitted. What did it tell you?
I didn't know what I believed. I think I thought that, you know, the system that I had been adhering to as a young adult would do whatever it could to protect the rights of individuals that were law-abiding citizens. But I learned quickly that it leans the other side to protect criminals. And when he was acquitted of that crime, it was incredibly disturbing and shocking. And I couldn't believe that I was witnessing that. I don't know how much of that had to do with our system as much as it had to do with the jury that acquitted him.
Now, will you remind those listening, because it is quite some time, and there may be even particularly younger listeners who have vague memories, recognise the names but may not recognise the details. Ron's part in this story, what was it?
My brother was a waiter at the restaurant where Nicole and her family were eating dinner that evening, and Nicole's mother, Judita, had left her sunglasses at the restaurant, and my brother was asked, or actually he volunteered, to bring the sunglasses back to Nicole that night before he went to meet a friend of his after work. And he encountered the person that killed him and Nicole, and he lost his life that night.
Now, we can all recall, I think, the images on the television, the chase, the bizarre nature of O.J. Simpson's dealing with the police and then subsequently the trial, the showbiz dimensions to it. For Europeans, of course, we were unused to seeing television cameras in a court, so it had all the flavour of a Friday night legal drama. But of course it wasn't a Friday night legal drama, it was your lives. When did you form an opinion as to whether O.J. Simpson had murdered your brother or not?
The DNA, definitely the DNA is when I remember when they put an exhibit up in the courtroom for the jury to see, and they started revealing all of the results of their DNA testing with the hair and the fibers and the socks and the blood. And when everything pointed to him, unequivocally him, there was no doubt in my mind that he was the person responsible for what, for Ron and Nicole's death. I mean, there was just, it was, I forget the statistics off the top of my head right now, but it was like 1 in a billion chance that it was anybody else but him. All of the evidence pointed to him.
And of course, at the time, he had a celebrity. He had a celebrity lawyer, now dead, Johnny Cochran, defending him.
Yeah, he had a team of attorneys that were working
very gifted people. Yeah.
You say gifted, I say other things.
Well, they were very gifted in the legal sense, in that they were able to present the case, if not the legal details, certainly because your statements about DNA would be, their opinions that would be shared by many people, that it, in the eyes of many, would almost conclusively lead you to the opinion that he was the murderer. But they managed, through sleight of hand, some would say, and presentation, to convince the jury that he was innocent, or that there was a doubt, at least, about his guilt.
Yeah, you know, in looking back, it's hard for me to understand how they did that. They just threw a bunch of theories out with no basis. And the truth is that you don't have to prove your theory. You just throw it out there and hope that something sticks. Unfortunately, in our courtroom, Judge Ito, I don't believe, had a tremendous amount of control in the courtroom and allowed things to come in that I don't believe should have. Issues of race were made a huge part of our case that I don't believe were necessary and supported by any fact, but yet that became such a huge component. The jury basically told us after the fact that they packed their bags weeks before and made up their minds. So at some point they stopped listening, so I don't know what would have made a difference.
Why do you think they believed that there may have been a doubt, that they could not beyond reasonable doubt say that he was responsible? What convinced them, do you think?
Well, if race was an issue in that case, I think that absolutely played a part in the verdict. But again, at some point they stopped listening. At some point they chose to turn a blind eye to the facts, and that's against the law. That's not what they're supposed to do. As according to the jury instructions, they're supposed to keep an open mind and they're supposed to hear the evidence and weigh the evidence. And the jury revealed in numerous interviews after the fact that they didn't do that. There were a couple of jurors that said that, you know, it's no big deal that he used to beat up his wife, that there's nothing wrong with that. And so I don't really know at the end of the day what was at play. His celebrity certainly didn't.
I was about to say that, his celebrity. Yeah. This was at a time when America was, you know, maybe uneasy and uncertain about its heroes. And this guy, people tend, maybe in this side of the Atlantic, not to understand what a star this guy was. He was iconic in stature, loved by the public, little known maybe about his private life. And certainly I think that did affect the way they made their judgment.
Yeah, and there was, you know, they pandered to the cameras and, you know, the cameras played a big part. The celebrity component of not only him, but of just, you know, we had TV stars and movie stars that would come in and hang out in the courtroom, and it just became such a circus, and you know, people were making book deals and selling their stories, and you know, there were cameras everywhere, and it became something of a mockery of our system. And we, I think, unfortunately, resulted in an acquittal because of some of those things.
Would you, and I think your family, were convinced that he was responsible? He himself, of course, O.J. Simpson, categorically denied being responsible. Whether you considered his excuses or explanations or his defence implausible or not, he certainly put up a pretty good performance of being enormously relieved and, you know, presented himself as a man who might have been wronged terribly but now was being set free. But you and your family categorically believed he was responsible.
Absolutely. There was, as I said, you know, the DNA clinched it for us. But, you know, in watching him for 9 months, as
what
we
was that
did,
like?
It was in the beginning, it was difficult for me to watch him come through the door every morning from his jail cell. I expected him to come in his jumpsuit, but he was always, you know, finely dressed, and his suits were always pressed, and he had a new one you know, now we find out that he had determined what days of the week he would wear certain clothing, what colors he would wear depending on the testimony. But it was, you know, he would come in and he'd wave to the room and he'd bow his head and welcome his guests. You know, he had a whole half the courtroom that was there to support him. And, you know, it was his show. And it was difficult. There was zero remorse for the situation, regardless of whether he was guilty or innocent. It was still the loss of life of two people. And he had zero remorse and still has zero remorse, especially when he sat down to write a book about it.
Now, the indignity that you suffered and your family with the trial, and I believe, you know, with everything that you've already described, including celebrity witnesses as well, where guys who wouldn't have stood a chance had been noticed on a street corner suddenly became temporary superstars as a result of this trial, must have been very damaging for you as a family.
Damaging is an understatement. I think that, you know, for us, it became, you know, people would joke about it. It was, you know, the top story on our on our late night television, and it still creeps in. You know, every month or so, there's a joke or there's a reminder about it. It's very personal to us. It's very private, and I think I can speak for both my father and I and the rest of our family that we often forget how widespread it was and how much it became part of our pop culture, so to speak. And so it was strange for me to have people sort of joking and making light of it, and it was just so personal to us that it was hard for me to separate out how it impacted others versus how it impacted us.
Well, if we concentrate just on your brother, but mindful that Nicole died a savage and awful death as well, these were people who were killed, murdered in a very brutal, very old, primitive way, an old-fashioned, brutal death. And then we think of, for instance, a colleague of mine who's often alluded to, he worked with Ruby Wax and she interviewed O.J. Simpson. And at one point in the interview, this friend of mine and colleague describes him taking out a banana and pretending to stab Ruby Wax with the banana.
I remember that.
And, okay, there is a sort of dark, bizarre humour to it. And in the half-breath, then you stop yourself, if you've any humanity, and you say, he is making fun of the brutal slaying of another human being.
I think you make a good point. You know, I'm not sure about your news, but I know for us, the first, you know, 17 minutes of our news is talking about all the rapes and the killings and all of the heinous behavior of people in our society. That's the top of the show. And I think as a society, we've become so desensitized to it that we don't even pay attention when, you know, lives are lost. You just hear it so often, you know, you hear the numbers of the people that are dying in war that you don't even pay attention to the brutality and to the loss of life. And so for us, as often as we can, I try to remind people about what he did. And I know it's hard to hear, but he nearly decapitated Nicole. He stabbed Ron in the heart. I mean, you know, Ron suffered over 30 wounds, four of which were fatal. Nicole, you know, had one fatal wound that was horrific to think about. And they were left at the bottom of her stairs for her children to find. I mean, this is not something that you should be taking lightly or to be joking about. But I think that people often forget that or just put it aside so you don't have to deal with it.
As time has gone by and this man has celebrated and then tried to figure out what to do with his freedom, O.J. Simpson had to face up to the fact that he was effectively bankrupt, really, in financial terms. So he needed to make money. He did several different things to try and come up with a revenue stream and eventually settled on writing a book in which he would suggest what might have happened on that night. A macabre, strange, but for a publisher, very attractive idea.
Almost heaven, West Virginia, Blue Ridge Mountains, Shenandoah River. Life is old there, older than the trees, younger than the mountains, growing like a breeze. Country roads take trees gather round her. Miner's lady, stranger to blue water. Dark and dusty, painted on the sky. Misty taste of moonshine, teardrop in my eye. Country road.
His decision to write this book, which eventually becomes Your Family's Property, which must still be a very bizarre experience for him as to how that happened. I'd say he's still trying to figure that one out. But his decision to write this, when did you hear about it?
Well, I heard about it in October of 2006, but I want to go back and touch on something that you said before the break, which was that he's nearly bankrupt. That is...
Certainly, that's public perception, anyway.
Yeah, and it's just the one of the other, you know, mistruths. And we have subpoenaed his financial records and his IRS tax returns, in which he reports upwards of $500,000 a year in income. So this is not someone who's bankrupt. He's living off of four pensions that we cannot touch. He's living in a state in which we can't touch his home, his equity line, any of his assets. We can't garnish his wages. This is someone who not at all is bankrupt or living a life of a pauper. The truth behind him writing this book, I think, was just to continue to generate more income. He walked away with close to $700,000 for writing that book and stood to make millions on the back end of it. I believe he did it to just increase his revenue stream, but I think he also did it because his ego drove him to it.
Yeah, I agree with you. I think that's maybe the most significant part of it. We'll talk again about, you know, the court case and the civil order given, which should have given you the right to be able to sequestrate his assets and get your hands on any revenue that he had, which, of course, it didn't, because he lives in a state that sort of protects his rights to a much greater degree than yours. But yes, I agree with you. I think, and many others would, that his ego, in fact, was probably the driving force.
Yeah, you know, when we first heard about it, you know, we were shocked about it to hear, but we didn't really understand the gravity of it at that point. We knew that, you know, there was a rumor that he was making $1 million advance, and this was a how-to manual. And we, of course, once the book came out, we did whatever we could to stop it from being put out into the mainstream, you know, for their reading ability. But at that point, again, we did not know entirely what the book consisted of. Once we finally sat down and read it and realized that it was not a how-to manual and that it read, as far as we were concerned, more of a confession, we felt better about putting that out into the public. And as a result of some of our issues in the legal system, we were awarded the rights to that book, but only as a result of him forcing the company into bankruptcy. The asset was seized by the bankruptcy court, and it was ordered to be monetized. And that's sort of how we ended up with it, not because we chose to have it.
It really shows you, though, how stark raving bonkers this person is, though, because if he was to continue to have garner, and he did have sympathy, you know, and may even still have sympathy in some quarters, in some society, in some communities, even those who loved him because of his sporting prowess or because of his celebrity appearances on television shows and in movies, they must have been shocked that he would, you know, dredge the depths of human depravity, really, to make a story, a show, an entertainment out of, if I killed her, right, this is what I would have done.
Right. And, you know, I think that's what people are starting to understand at this point, you know, that an innocent person doesn't sit down and write this about the mother of his children.
No.
And an innocent man that lost his life alongside her. I mean, this was someone that, you know, was driven to the brink of what I believe is destruction. And I think, you know, it is amazing to me once you read it, that you get the insight into the mind of an abuser and the mind of a killer, as far as we're concerned. And I think people are starting to be reminded about the brutality of what he did. And I at least hope that the next time someone goes to shake his hand or to get an autograph, they are reminded about what he did and what he was willing to let you read. I mean, that he created this, we didn't.
Yeah, but that's actually, I had to stop myself. You know, this morning I'd been away for the weekend. I took the book away with me to a very beautiful part of Ireland, the south of Ireland. And I was reading it at the weekend. And as I looked out across the Atlantic, as I looked at my own family and my wife and the vitality of their lives, mm-hmm. and I thought, how could this person, if he was completely innocent and, you know, even partially temporarily psychotic, how could he write this?
Right. And that's sort of what we felt, you know. I mean, it was shocking when we first heard about it that he would sit down and do this, that he would do it with a reputable publishing house, that it would be done, you know, on the down low so that our family didn't know about it. And then once you actually read it, you're thinking, wow, you know, it's really, in his mind, I think it was to glorify himself. And in our mind now, it's, you know, we want to turn his words on him and vilify him again. I you know, we've gotten away from ostracizing him and treating him like a piranha in our country. And I would encourage people to read it and to get back to basics as far as we're concerned.
Now, he describes Nicole and his relationship with her and meeting her. There's a lot of sort of, you know, romantic stories and things like that in the beginning of it. And then it gets to the point of that evening. Mm-hmm. And he describes very clear and calculating the night in question. I think it's the chapter, isn't it?
Yeah, that's the title of the chapter. He walks us through it. And the truth is, it doesn't deviate from the criminal case or the civil case testimony. He puts himself there. He puts the knife in his hand. He puts himself in an agitated state. And, you know, the taunting of my brother and the mocking him for trying to defend himself. He blacks out, of course, for the actual crime, but then wakes up, as you read earlier, with, you know, pools of blood and a knife in his hand. He doesn't implicate anybody else except himself.
19-92. Jerry Ryan on 2FM.
How's it going? It's Dave Fanning here for a special edition of Knob Factor of all things, and we're searching for fellas to form a Westlife tribute band, which we call Knob Life, believe it or not.
Dave, what are you doing, Dave?
Oh, Simon, of course, Mr. Knob Factor Nasty is here as well. I was just wondering about Westlife's pseudo-metamorphosis from uber boy band teen pop into quasi-neo-ultra-adult contemporary music group.
Just shut up and bring out the first audition.
All right. Okay, the first one out is Christy Moore.
How's it going there, everybody, and you're welcome to this evening's cabaret.
Okay, let's see what you got.
Oh, going into Yes or for a pick of the day. any sausages think of the X Factor Fix Me John Deere tractor and that Simon Cowell character with his hair that never changes.
Dave, he's sweating too much. Why is he sweating, Dave?
Oh, sweating like a sheep shagger at a Sheeran festival in Kilchima. Pass me your towel and me plaster and towel. Don't forget the shovel if you want to go to work. Oh, he's a sheep shagger.
Terrible.
Oh, lads. Sweaty, steaming, boiling sheep shagger.
I'm sorry, I've had enough. This poor man is dehydrating. It's a no.
All right, sorry about that there, Chrissy. Anyway, we've got loads more auditions. Next one's a Rastafarian Dunamede boxer, Damien Dempsey.
How are you, Simon?
Hello.
How are you, Dave?
Hey.
I want to sing straight from soul and passion and heart about Bertie Ahern and Mary Harney and all the politicians crucifying the sick and suffering in our hospitals.
Let's hear it.
Patients, will you look after our bleeding patients, Lord?
What?
It's a disgrace in the A&D.
I'm sorry, Damo. You're way too aggressive, too belligerent, mate. I'm sorry.
It's passion, Simon. No. Pure, raw, indigenous, downtrodden, tormented passion.
It's a no.
I'll burst you open, Cole.
Get him out
I'll pull
here.
Your high-waisted trousers up to your neck.
Okay, all right, okay. Go away, Damo, will you, for God's sake, okay? Anyway, so we need something more kind of slow and easy and kind of middle of the road. I thought it was Daniel is your only man. Come on, Daniel.
There he is. A big shout-out to all me Donegal fans and muffs.
Hang on a second. I don't like your look already, especially the jumper has to go...
Hush your mouth, Cole. Me mammy knitted this out of 100 old tea cosies.
I'm sorry, it has to go.
Hey, let's hear the song anyway, Daniel. Go on there.
Why not? It's a 50-cent number because I feel like getting down with me mo-fopping homies like Big Tom and that whole bitch Susan McCann.
Oh, my Lord.
So special. Daniel O'Donnell. Mary Dove.
What?
Donny God. God damn. She wants tea. I want to get it to her. She wants tea. Come on and get it
it's
from
a no.
me.
It's a no. Get out.
Hush. Go and frig yourself, Carol, you big girl's blood.
All right, Daniel, okay.
Absolute.
I'll see you later, okay. Stop that, Daniel. Anyway, it's Enda Kenny next there, lads.
Who's your mummy? Do you want your old lovey washed down, can shine?
Wow.
Do you want your old lovey washed down?
Okay, Enda, I love it. I think your hairstyle is amazing.
Thank you.
I think people will buy your records because they will feel sorry for you.
What?
It's a yes. Finally, we've got our first members of Knob Life now. Well done, Enda. Very fancy, okay, now all we need is a good-looking one.
How are you, lads? How are you doing? I think I should be in the band, you know.
Why?
Sure. Nicky's me son-in-law. And I've always been a big fan of the rest of the lads in the Westies.
Okay, it's
thanks,
a yes.
Thanks for that.
That's number two. We also need a gay one.
Now, for God's sake, Simon, where the hell are we going to find a...
I think I'm your metro man, as sound as the pink pound.
Senator Norris is perfect for the role. Now all we need is the short one.
What?
Could I possibly be of some service, Simon?
Michael Tree.
I'm exactly the same size as E.T. and not much unlike him either.
I think that's it. Knob Life is ready.
Fantastic.
Stop, hang on a second.
Louis Welsh, what the hell?
It's a rip-off, Simon.
No.
It's a rip-off.
Oh, God.
It's my band.
Come
it's
on.
Westlife. You're trying to rip me
rubbish.
Off.
Rubbish.
You're doing this all your
lies.
Life, Simon. You're doing this all your
what
life.
A turn.
I'm not going to put up with it anymore.
I'm not.
Simon,
rubbish
Simon,
to
no.
you, Louis.
Simon, no.
Always.
Simon, no.
Last word.
I'm not going to get away with this time.
Rubbish.
It's my band.
Get
hang on.
Knob Nation is out now.
The best of the Jerry Ryan Show comedy series on one fantastic album.
It's bleeding better than Nicky from Boys Life.
Sign the contract.
Get your knobs out for Ireland.
Available now in all good record stores and some crap ones as well.
RTE, supporting the knobs.
Mary, good morning to you.
Good morning, Jerry.
Welcome, and thank you for calling us, and thank you for being brave enough to call.
You're welcome.
Okay, now, you were listening.
Yes.
Okay. And we have an email, I think, from you here as well, don't we?
Mm-hmm, that's
okay.
Right.
It says, I was travelling in Greece when I experienced my first diagnosed manic episode.
Mm-hmm.
I was doing strange things like giving away all my stuff, not eating, not sleeping, and lost all my listening skills. I was 26.
Mm-hmm.
Had you a sense that this was wrong? What was happening to you?
At that time, that was the first time I went manic, and I didn't have a real sense of what was happening. I knew there was something wrong.
What did you think was happening to you?
Well, it was quite a spiritual journey at the time, and people will often explain mania in that way. It seems to take two main roads. You either get anger and, you know, a lot of frustration, or you go into kind of spiritual happy land where everything is normalized, even though it's not normal to other people. And I was living alone at the time. And it just seemed that, you know, strange things were happening to me. Like, I imagined at one point the radio was talking directly to me every time I turned it on and things like that.
And what were you hearing from the radio talking directly to you?
Just messages, like, that I felt were coming from the universe at the time. And, you know, this kind of
thing. These seemed absolutely real.
Totally real. Yeah. And I was maintaining at that time a life at the same time, and I was working in Ballinasloe. I remember one instance, and at the Ballinasloe, I was working teaching drama and that kind of thing. And I inhabited a world full of artists and musicians and artists, and you know, strange behaviour was there with girl. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah, so in a more conventional community, you might have stood out a bit more. Yeah, sure.
Yeah. And at that time, I said, everyone was kind of like, Mary's a bit strange, but she's just been Mary. Do you know what I mean?
And in fact, they probably said,
a heightened version of myself.
Yeah, isn't she lovely? In her own way.
In her own way. And if she just shut up. Because I couldn't stop talking. And that was the one overwhelming thing I remember. I couldn't stop. The voice kept going and going and going. And as I was sleeping less and less, eating less and less. I went down to about a size 8, and I'm a healthy size 12 normally. And I just was skin and bone, really. And I had very long hair right down to my backside, and I cut it all off, shaved my hair. Did, you know, extreme things. And you know, even though, as I said and told you in the email, I grew up with manic depression, it didn't click with me that this was what was wrong with me. And
did you ever stop? I mean, for instance, you know, in the half moment between waking and sleeping, when we often think of things that are significant or important to us, did you ever consider what was happening to you? Did you?
I would have moments of like total lucidity, and I would be scared out of my mind. You know, I knew there was something dreadfully wrong in those moments, but at that time I had no experience of the services, or no experience of a diagnosis, or no experience.
And did you just think, this is my personality? It's unfortunate.
Yeah, this is not
something that's wrong with me. This is my personality.
And I have a very vivid imagination at the best of times. And, like, I was doing a lot of painting and writing and, you know, producing work as well. And it just seemed to be part of the artistic bent in me or whatever. And that's what I was putting it down to. And it then, you know, it reached its zenith when I, of course, ended up in Greece. And wandering around Greece on a Greek island and partying all night on water, like not drinking, not smoking, not doing any drugs, just happy out. And knew everyone on the island within a week. Do you know that kind of way? Running around and getting to know everyone. And then one morning I left the little B&B where I was staying and I went for a swim. And the next thing I remember is being handcuffed to a guard or, a Greek policeman.
Yeah.
And I was on a ferry and I had no idea what was going on.
How would you end up with the policeman?
Well, when I had gone for the swim, and this is the funny bit, I suppose I laugh now, I forgot to put my clothes on and I was wandering around a Greek Orthodox island, totally stark naked.
Yeah, and contrary to what people may think, the Greeks do get a bit huffy
about
it. They
do get a bit huffy about it, yeah. And it took them about half a day to catch me or something. I heard from somebody afterwards.
So you were running around in the nip on the island.
Yeah, I was. Yeah.
But you had no memory of that.
No, I have bits of memory, I call it. You know, like slithers of memory. And I remember women and men trying to stop me from whatever I was doing. I was running here and running there and that kind of thing.
And what did they do?
They were just trying to catch me, to help me, but I thought they were... I didn't realise I was naked, right? And I was just running. And at that stage, I would have been what they call psychotic. Like, there is manic, and then the next step is psychotic, when you enter into a dream landscape. That's what it's like. Like, your dream becomes real, and you're walking around in a dream landscape, and everything is... At that stage, everything's real. The hallucinations, everything is real to you, and you're the only person that can see it. Anyone watching you will see you making strange movements and so on, but to you it's absolutely real.
So you're making no value judgments whatsoever?
No.
Anything, it's all based on completely unreliable information.
Yeah, yeah. Yeah.
So you can't take care of yourself. You mean you're a real danger.
I mean, I could have walked into the sea or jumped off a building. You're the classic, you know, the classic examples of.
Were
what
you
may
hallucinating?
Happen.
Do you know?
Yes, I was definitely. Yeah, I definitely was hallucinating.
And what were you hallucinating? Can you remember? Have you any sense of what was?
At the time. Not so much that time, because it was so deluded. It's hard to articulate it now, you know. It was just I was in a magic world, and everything was beautiful. The universe was sensational. I could spend hours staring at a rock.
And of course, hallucinations don't have to be images. Hallucinations
no,
can
they
be
don't.
An altered perception of reality.
Totally, that's it, Jerry. Yeah, totally altered perception. Like, you know, I mean, I'm not a drug person. I've never done drugs. But, like, when people talk about...
I don't think you need to.
No, I don't. That's what my friends tell me. That I'd be found 20 years
from
now.
Oh, no, you'd probably be a bit...
Connemara.
I think you would be a bit disappointed, in fact, if you did. So, I mean, the Greeks... What way did they deal with this?
Oh, that was tough. Because I had no prior... at that point, I had no prior hospitalisation. So my initial hospitalization was coming to in a Greek hospital, and it was filthy dirty, men and women thrown in together. Like, they're about 50 years behind our system, you know. And no explanation as to why I was being given drugs, and I had no explanation as to why or what was going on. Nobody had any English to speak to me anyway. And I just remember when I kind of came, you do come to. I mean, they were giving me Largactyl, which is a drug, an antipsychotic drug, and you can't go out into the sunlight with that, and I didn't realise
that
at the time.
Yeah, you're photosensitive,
Yeah, and they were keeping me in, and they wouldn't let me out at all, so I felt caged and trapped, and when I came to, I just started screaming for the Irish Embassy. I remember distinctly sitting under a table, and all I had left in the world was the dress I was wearing. I hadn't a thing. I'd lost everything. And I had a little Bible with me. And I don't know where it came from, Jerry. It was in my stuff, but I actually had the Bible as well. And I used to sit and read the Bible just to keep sane. And my cousin came to collect me from London. She's an air hostess. And she came a week later. The friends I'd made on the island knew where I was staying, so the police found my passport and contacted my parents. It was an awful shock to my parents. They got this call. They live in Mayo, and... You know, they got this call out of the blue, your daughter's had a psychotic attack in Greece. They didn't even know I was in Greece, you know. And it was all very disturbing. And it was like Midnight Express or something. I was putting the drugs under my tongue and flushing them down the toilet.
Oh, no, I was in hospital on Santorini, the island of Santorini.
Yeah.
I was there not because of a psychotic episode, but because of a prolonged bout of diarrhoea.
Slightly different,
and it wasn't very pleasant in the hospital.
You were probably having hallucinations at that point.
I was not far from it, I have to tell you. But for you, this must have been a really frightening experience, because probably nobody was speaking English to you.
Nobody.
And so they weren't explaining to you.
The only way I could communicate with people was, like, they would give me cigarettes. You know, they'd come up and give me a cigarette, and that was the way we'd communicate.
So had the issue of mental health been even broached at that point?
No, not at all, no. They gave me a letter and told me to give it to my doctor when I got back. And what happened then, I got back to Galway. I was based in Galway at the time. And the drug they had been giving me was a drug called Serenade. And it's haloperidol, it's better known as. And it's quite an old psychotic. And if you come off it too quickly, your body goes into this kind of... it's like you feel ants under your skin and you can't sit down or stand up or you can't function. And I went into the state, and I went up to A&E. I still didn't know what was wrong with me. And they had no beds, so they were giving me injections and sending me home. And I was wandering around my friend's flat in this state for about 4 or 5 days. And that was really horrendous. And then they finally found a bed for me. And I'll always remember the morning I was diagnosed, because two doctors came to my bedside, and just they had taken some notes about my past. At some point, and this doctor was very cavalier. He just looked at the chart and went, well, it's obviously manic depression. I don't know what the problem is, and walked off and left me like that. That's how I found out. And there was no counselling, no advice, no backup, nothing. And at that point, it was a horrendous feeling, because my father is manic as well, manic depression, but he had a more kind of angry version of it than me. And I thought that was my future. Do you know what I mean? And I sat there, lay there in that bed thinking, Oh, my God.
And up till then, had you suspected anything? Had any of your friends or family or anybody said, you know, you might be psychiatrically unwell?
Because I suppose, looking back, hindsight's a great teacher. And, yeah, I would have been manic when I was 22.
But you didn't suspect anything. You just no idea. You were just afraid.
I was petrified. Yeah. Like, I remember my first breakdown was when I was 17, if I'm, you know, honest. And I remember a physical shattering and a mental shattering. I remember the sensation.
What happened? Why did that happen? What triggered that?
Well, a friend of mine was, someone very close to me, was drowned in a fishing accident and died very suddenly. And I couldn't cope. I just moved to a new town, new university, all that. I was 17 and I just couldn't cope. And those days, like, people would say at the graveside, like, you're lucky you're not married or are connected to this person. And, you know, there was no kind of sense of sensitivity about how I might feel. No counselling offered, nothing like that. And I was just left to my own devices, and I didn't do very well for a long time. And I remember burning my medical card because I was so petrified of someone copping on. Do you know what I mean?
That there was something wrong with you.
Yeah. And so I just struggled through massive depressions from the age of 17 to 20. Every winter I would just go into hideous depressions. But the elation didn't start until my 20s, which is, I think, you know, which is quite common. And, you know, but as I said, the initial diagnosis was quite tough. And the whole thing around Greece and everything. I mean, it's a great party story now. I laugh about it and I tell it.
It wasn't a laugh at the time,
No, it wasn't. No, but
so the system really didn't help you at the time?
No, it didn't pick me up in any shape or form at that time.
Now, cavalier and all as this doctor may have been, were they able to put you in the right direction? Were they able to access the kind of therapy or treatment that you needed?
It took 2 years for me to balance out. From 26 to 28, I was in and out of hospital on different meds, and nothing seemed to be kind of working as such. Because it's like fine tuning an engine, Jerry. You can't have a one drug fit all scenario, and a lot of doctors tend to think like that. And you have to fight for the drugs that are suit you, in my experience, because they'll give you any old thing initially just to diagnose, take this, go home. But like, some drugs make you really heavy, some drugs make you sleep all the time, some drugs affect your mind, your thinking, to such a degree that you can't function. And I didn't want any of that, do you know? And I kept going back and saying, this is not working. And they wouldn't give me any alternatives until I stopped taking the medication. And then suddenly there was alternatives.
You know, and were these psychiatrists?
And like, the psychiatrist I saw after I was diagnosed sat down and said to me, your judgment's been impaired since birth, just get used to it. That was his advice to me, Jerry. And I had a degree at that stage. I had published work. I had sold art around the world. You know, I had done lots of things. I travelled. And he's sitting there telling me that my judgment was impaired and that was it, and get used to it.
Well, you know, your judgment may have been impaired, but telling you to get used to it was extremely unhelpful. It was a callous way of dealing with you. And also, from a practical point of view, utterly redundant.
Oh, yeah, I didn't feel any support at that point. But, you know, you just feel left on your own, Jerry. And to a huge degree, you are on your own because, like, you know, I'm much more into the positive side of the illness now. Because it's under control. I'm fine, thank God.
Well, you don't sound manic or psychotic.
No,
this morning.
Not at all.
No.
No, I'm very together these days. But
and what do you put that down to? You must have met somebody along the way who was able to help you.
Well, I put it down to a lot of support from family and friends, and I was in London for a few years, quite a few years, and I had a great psychiatric team there, and they taught me how to identify triggers, you know, how when you're going up or when you're going down, and what to do, and that kind of.
Did they teach you what things to avoid that might trigger off things?
Yeah, you have to be careful around certain things, and
like what, for instance,
well,
in your case,
you have to avoid stress. But who can avoid stress, Jerry? You know, there's good stress and bad stress, as I call it.
If only you didn't have to go to work, Mr. Ryan, you'd be fine.
Well, that's
not an option.
Well, that's another huge area as well, Jerry, like getting back into work and you feel you have to hide all this.
Did you
all
find
the time.
I was just, well, do you know what? You're telepathic, not psychotic, telepathic. I was about that whole issue of will I or won't I tell them about my condition?
It's huge. It's absolutely huge. And it causes so much stress on top of the stress of looking for work, you know, that kind of way. But when I went to England, when I levelled out at 28 or whatever, and I took off because I couldn't live with the stigma either in Ireland. Even Galway, with the most laid-back people in the world, they did look at view. Certain people began to view me differently because there was a label on me, and I didn't like that feeling. And I thought, I need to get away and prove to myself I can stand on my own 2 feet, first of all. And if I can't, then I will come home, you know. And I went, and I got a job teaching in Clacton-on-Sea in Essex. And I was there for a term through an agency, and then they offered me a full-time position. And I agonised over it because I thought, if I take a full-time position here, I have to be honest about my past, and because it may crop up again.
Yeah.
And I went to the headmaster and I told him my situation. He was very understanding. But nonetheless, I had to go through a five-hour session with the school doctor. 5 hours. And every detail of my illness and everything that happened to me. And she bombarded me, right? And her attitude at the end of it was, I was just seeing how you coped under stress. Like, would you do that to somebody else who was just getting a job? Do you know what I mean? And that's the kind of thing you face, or you just don't mention it. And then if it comes up, you feel, if someone takes 2 weeks off for the flu, it's not the end of the world. But if you say, I have to pop into my psychiatric hospital for 10 days and then I'll be okay, they look at you, you know? That's not possible.
Well, it's all to do with the public perception, and sometimes justified, more often than not justified, but the public perception that you may be unreliable or even dangerous.
Yeah.
And I think
it's a terrible assumption, because it's so untrue. I mean, I've met the gentlest people in psychiatric wards you'll ever meet in your life. It's the opposite. Like, do you know what I mean?
Well, it's going back to what we were saying about our understanding of psychiatric illness. There are definitely people who are very dangerous to themselves,
and as a result
of delusion and psychosis, can do terrible things to themselves or to other people. But that they're in a minority. Okay,
I think the public
need to be able to separate their appreciation of that area from the area that, for instance, you inhabited. I mean, the biggest threat was to yourself, really, and to your well-being.
No, I was never, thank God, never, you know, harmful to anybody or anything like that.
Were you ever suicidal?
Oh, yeah. I've walked that road a few times.
And did you ever try to actually take your own life?
No. I came very close to it one night in Galway when I was about 18.
And was that circumstances or because of the illness?
Well, it was a bit of both, I think, at the time. I was just overwhelmed. Those years were overwhelming. And I look back on them now and I feel for any child that's at that age and something major happens.
And you obviously, maybe I'm being too presumptuous, but you seem to have a coping mechanism now that I would suspect prevents that from being an issue now.
Yeah, I say that, but like I still, when I get into my depression, I still have to battle against depression. Yeah. And, you know, I feel, you know, you talk about the services a little while ago. The services have to be commended for one thing. They're very good on crisis intervention. You know, when you're high as a kite or when you're low down, you get
them. What do you do when that happens?
I ring my psychiatric nurse and say I'm in trouble. But I don't always get the backup and support that I need.
What does your psychiatric nurse do then?
Well, they would visit me and assess the situation.
And sometimes is that enough? Just the contact?
It is at that time, but like you don't see them in the meantime, and it's not because they're bad people; it's because they're under resourced.
Sure.
So that's the point. There's no the backup, and I'm sure a lot of people, you know, a lot of people listening this morning will identify with this, especially in rural Ireland. There isn't the backup. You don't see your psychiatric nurse from one end of the week to the other, or month to the other. But like, they just don't have the resources to do that, to give a backup service, and that's vital to health. I had that all the time in London. I don't have it in Ireland.
Are you on medication?
Mm-hmm.
What are you on?
I take lithium. Yeah. And I had a terrible time with lithium because it's supposed to be the magic drug for manic depression, you know, and you take the lithium and you're okay. And it made me violently ill and dizzy, but I stuck with it. And it doesn't really keep me from going up, and it doesn't keep me from going down totally. So I have to take another drug to keep me from going high, which is called Abilify.
Mm-hmm.
It's an antipsychotic drug. and I also take Tegretol, which keeps me from going too low. So I have a, you know, an unnatural balance now, if you know what I mean.
So this is it's quite a juggling act, isn't it?
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah.
And to get that right, one thing about medication maybe that a lot of people don't appreciate, and you can start off with your, for instance, your statins, you know, your anti-cholesterol medication. Mm. You might take that at night, roughly at the same time. And why is that? Well, because you'll either under-medicate or over-medicate yourself.
Yeah.
Now, that's not good for the old ticker. And in your case, exactly the same thing can happen. Mm-hmm. Not good for the old mind.
No.
So you have to follow a pattern of behaviour. You have to be very consistent. And, of course, sometimes the very thing that you're trying to legislate against is actually acting against you, mm-hmm. taking care of yourself.
Yeah.
It's quite a dilemma, isn't it?
Quite a dilemma, yeah.
So, have you conquered that? Have you got a regime, a day-to-day regime?
Yeah, I have,
that
yeah.
you can rely on, that takes you through the day?
The last few years have been tough because I went into what they call rapid cycling, Jerry. I don't know if you've come across that. You know, after the initial grease thing, it took months to go up and months to come down, you know? But then I was fine for about 8 years, not a bother. And then I came off my medication and tried alternative medicine because I was determined to cure myself. But I spent quite a lot of money training to be a homeopath and all the rest of it, got really into it and then got very ill. And I would advise people to be very careful. You know, it's homeopathy and all these alternative medications are brilliant for things like skin conditions and so on.
But you'll usually find in mental health, homeopathy works fine when the issue is dealing with a circumstantial problem that's creating a psychiatric effect, and the homeopathy is a nice little placebo to throw into the mix, and it can work quite well there. In cases like yours, I think you're bipolar, are you?
Yeah.
In cases like yours, that don't work, baby.
No, it certainly doesn't. And it came back with a vengeance, absolute vengeance. You know, I was going up and down every couple of weeks, just unbelievable. I'd walk down
and
the street.
And in fact, I will say to anybody in the business of homeopathy, when you're dealing with people who are suffering from mental illness or trying to deal with
living
with it,
you really want to move in with them, Jerry. Do you know what I mean? And you're not going to do that. Nobody's going to do that.
Very, very careful.
Yeah, very careful.
So how are you now?
I'm great. I'm 100% great. I'm feeling very healthy and very happy. I'm waiting to hear about a job. Yeah. Waiting to get some teaching hours and hoping they haven't made a decision yet, so you know, hopefully they'll make the right decision. But even though, you know, I'm fine, and like health is number one to me, obviously. And
are you in a relationship? Are you? Because bipolar is a real enemy of relationships.
Yeah, there is someone in my life, but I don't want to discuss that on radio.
Okay, all right. But that's not beyond your reach,
No, no, no. But the whole issue of children, which is a huge issue.
Do you know
issue.
What? That's exactly what I was going to ask you again. Mm. Children, which you have a right to have?
Well, some people would think I don't, others would think, go for it, don't be silly,
no,
you know,
I think it's just a practical question, really, as to whether would the whole issue of pregnancy, would the issue...
Oh, it could, if I become pregnant, I have to come off all my medication, and you don't know, I might be fine, or I might be up and down, and some women level out completely after having a baby, and who knows, you know, but I've never
taken
the chance.
How will you make that decision?
I don't know, it's been made for me, really, in one sense, because I'm 39 now at the end of the month, and I haven't had a child up to now.
TikTok,
yeah, it's pretty major at the moment. And I love children, and I'm very fond of children, and I've always...
And you could still do it.
I could still do it, but I don't think it's likely, no, I really don't, because it's too much of a risk, Jerry.
Well, you know what, if you get that teaching job, you'll become a mother. There's no other way to describe it.
Yeah. Well, this is your third parent to all your children when you're teaching, so...
Well, listen, it's been really lovely talking to you.
Yeah,
and I believe useful, too.
I hope it helps somebody.
To others listening. And you're a brave woman, Mary. Because sometimes people are very coy about this.
Well, anything I can do to highlight it, Jerry, because that's part of the problem in this country. We don't talk about it enough, and you know, that stigma and that horror. People have come up to me and said, "Like, I'd rather have cancer than have what you've got." Do you know what I mean? That's awful.
Well, you haven't got cancer, and you
sound
like you're doing fine to me.
And I wouldn't touch Stephen Fry's magic button either. Did you see the documentary?
Oh, geez.
I wouldn't change who I am because I'm Mary and I'm quite happy to be Mary.
He has changed. Yeah, but he did say that he's changed for the better. All right, Mary, good luck to you.
Good luck, Jerry.
Take care. God
bye,
bless.
Bye, God bless.
Jerry Ryan, the Ryan Line.